Shocked if we see some of these guys roll dwarf, because then you can immune the bleed off even the rogues as well. So we'll have to see. I mean, Gingy's rogue is named Gingy Dwarf, so I'm going to go out on a limb and assume that that is a dwarf rogue.
Yeah, so something to remember, of course, about if they were to go dwarf for that bleed, that they can't all change race at the end of a dungeon. So only one member of the team can change their class's race or their class itself at the end of a dungeon. So every player is going to be Night Elf as much as possible in here.
Let's have a sneaky peeky. It looks like we certainly have Gingy Dwarf. I believe Frag might also be dwarf by the looks of it there.
Yep.
He is quite short in stature compared to his fellow Night Elf. So two dwarves off the bat, and we're seeing a big pull coming up here in a second, what I predict at least for Method EU.
Huge pulls. Looks like three packs for Method EU, and looks like a little bit smaller, only two packs here on the side of Abrakeydabra. Now, these two teams did both do this dungeon in time trials, where Abrakeydabra was just a little bit slower than Method EU, which had the first place time in this dungeon.
Actually, it looks like Method EU pulled the entire room, save one mob that they're saving for the very end so that they can proc Reaping likely on top of the Golden Serpent, because it does RP a bit, fly around the edges of the room. So pretty much a full room pull here for Method EU, as we see now kind of kite backwards. A lot of damage coming up from them. We are, of course, back in this Bursting Skittish. Well, not back to Skittish. We haven't Skittish yet today, but we are back in Bursting Skittish Sours.
Oh, yeah. So these mobs have a lot of health, so Bursting isn't going to be much of a threat, but Skittish definitely is. So Warriors probably have the least difficulty of any tank on Skittish, because they're doing so much damage with their Thunderclap. So they're able to kite away from those mobs. And if these mobs get ripped off the tank at any point by the DPS, with some of these large mobs will enrage, and they're just going to one-shot any DPS instantly if they ever swing on them.
Bit of a scary moment there for now, as he sub 10%. I mean, you do have enrage from the big Guardians hitting him quite hard, along with any Bursting stacks. Bursting, of course, once you kill a mob, it will give you a 4-second dot that can stack if you keep killing them. So, could spell disaster for the tank. No problem this time, though, as the Golden Serpent will be momentarily spawning for Method EU, getting ready to pull it right as soon as it lands on top of them. There it is right now. They've, of course, have already used their Bloodlust. Won't be available to them. Abrakeydabra only now killing the trash, but they do have their Bloodlust available.
Yeah, so the Bloodlust on the Reaping is maybe interesting. So, we haven't seen how either of these teams have handled this dungeon during time trials. They were not streaming their attempts, and I don't believe they've released any VODs or any recording of any of them. So we know that Method EU does have a fast time, but Abrakeydabra is right behind them on their heels.
Yeah, I mean, we do see the Bloodlust finally go up for Abrakeydabra as the Golden Serpent spawns for them, absolutely decimating this first Reaping wave in a similar fashion that Method, both teams actually just pulled both of the first Reaping right on top of that Serpent boss. Now, this is a full melee comp for both sides, so dealing with those Golden Pools and, of course, the Ooey Gooeys that spawn there is going to be pretty crucial for both teams. One slip up, Sours, and we're going to get that Absorb on the boss.
Yeah, luckily, these Goos were nerfed quite a lot a while back, so they have 75% less health than they had, I believe, at the start of the expansion. And if one of these Goos ever, these gold guys ever hit the boss, it's a massive, massive absorb shield on the Golden Serpent, and there's no coming back from that. So you gotta kill these, you gotta paralyze them. Looks like they've got these mobs entangled, blinded, paralyzed. Method EU doing a really good job at handling those animated gold puddles.
Method EU certainly going for gold right now. Golden Serpent at 47% for them, just slowly kiting away as that gust comes in. We'll do a moderate amount of physical damage if you get caught in it, but also punt you a fair ways off. Doing a really good job here, both teams as well, to keep those pools together. You want to localize those mobs as much as possible. It helps with CC if needed, whether it's a Typhoon or Ursul's Vortex in support coming out from the Resto Druid, a Ring of Peace, whatever have you. But it helps a lot, because if you put them as too far opposite sides of the platform, they could actually start pouring around the other side of the central area.
Yeah, so you've got to be really careful with where you tank this boss and where you drop these gold puddles, because if these animated golds start coming at you from both sides of the room, it could very easily run out of space when the boss is stationary casting any of its abilities, which is going to be very hard to recover from. And when you kill these animated golds, this puddle that you see on the ground will do damage very fast as soon as it hits the ground, and it does a lot of damage to players. It'll chunk them, maybe even two ticks I think is going to be enough to kill them, especially on an 18 tyrannical.
Yeah, bit of a close call there for Method EU, as they kind of just kill those two goos right beside the boss, giving now the space he needs to safely get the serpent through. But they're starting to pour out the other side, exactly what we were talking about here. They're now being pincered on either end by those golds coming in. They're trying to just go all in here, I'm pretty sure, kill the boss off before these goos reach. Do absolutely anything you can to keep them away. We see a stun come in there from Gingy Dwarf as he kind of just desperately tries to claw at the boss, making sure it gets killed. They should be able to clinch it off. Abrakeydabra has caught up a bit because of that poor Method EU positioning, and they're only separate by 5% now.
Right. You lose a lot of damage and uptime with these melee-heavy comps when you have bad boss positioning. They were so far away from the door also when the boss died, whereas Abrakeydabra is much closer. They have to run just a little bit less to the gauntlet. They're only a little bit behind. Now, something I don't think we've talked about yet in this gauntlet is that this is another thing that's been standardized for the MDI, where all of these mini-bosses are always going to be spawning in the same order, starting from the front left and then going in a U-shape around the room towards the entrance.
That's right. Yeah, we mentioned that yesterday, but definitely important for everybody to know that at home today, so it keeps the playing field even. We have seen some teams kind of pull those first two constructs that are skipped at the beginning of the dungeon into this room, and here they come right now for Method EU. Now, this is a really dangerous pull, Sours, because of that frontal that we just saw right now. It's a very limited space environment. You will be displaced by several of these mini-bosses in this gauntlet, so if you kind of step into the wrong place on one of those frontals, you're going to get in trouble.
Yeah, these guys luckily have a nice pre-viz to see where the frontal is going, but if you get hit by them, it's going to stun you for a significant amount of time and do a ton of damage to you. And these guys, it can be quite hard to tell, honestly, where they're facing. They look very tubular, and you see them inside of each other, and so it's really nice to be able to be looking at the floor to make sure you don't get stunned and killed by these
guys. Yeah, I have found it also equally difficult to see which direction to look at if my monitor is turned off, but oftentimes, as long as you're paying attention, you do see the direction they're cast in, though it is easy to lose focus, especially with this particular mini-boss pack that spawned, as you will have that axe barrage going out. Some teams opt to try and line of sight it elsewhere just because it's a huge bleed on the group, and they're also responsible for punting, as we saw that Typhoon come in from Zalia there, once that storm goes off from the second mob.
Yeah, so Method EU just hit now the 40% mark, so the next wave of reaping is going to come in. And something that's really scary in the King's Rest dungeon is that so many of these mobs are the smash type mobs. And when you're in this room dealing with, now they've got a mind control, this next mob is going to either cast a mind control on a player as well as some of these shadow bolts that have come out. And the other guy is going to do a blade storm. And the blade storm does a lot of damage. So it is tyrannical, not fortified, so the blade storm isn't going to kill you instantly here. But if you take a couple of ticks of it, it's really dangerous. And so dealing with the slams, dealing with the blade storm, dealing with the mind control, it's very easy for a member to get picked off randomly here.
But not even that, it's just a huge DPS loss because they mainly need to run away as soon as that storm comes in. But there's a bit of min-maxing once again, favor of prot warrior that can be done with the shadow bolts, getting that reflect in as appropriate on the queen. King is now left as the queen goes down for Method EU on the left side. Certainly right on their heels as Abrakeydabra downing those two big lost souls. We have a death come here from Mears, unfortunately. First death of the match. Immediately get that battle res off. They will not have that available again for another 2 minutes.
That's right. So luckily with these rogues, if you check the extension tool with our tooltips powered by Wowhead, you can see that these rogues are opting to use acrobatic strikes to give them an additional 3 yards of attack range on them, which gives them just enough attack range to stay outside of Bladestorm, as well as a lot of other mechanics that are very dangerous for melee, such as these slams on the ground and the hunting leap and everything else that can really have a chance to give melees a really rough time.
Yeah, acrobatics certainly increasing their effective DPS, allowing them to safely maneuver out of a lot of the void zones that we're seeing go down here, and we'll actually continue to see with some of the upcoming trash and bosses as well. Method EU now goes through the gauntlet. They did suffer the death, though. They will have their one battle res available. Hopefully they won't need it, but some really nasty trash is coming up. As every other team we see in King's Rest, they do skip past this purification construct. Sometimes, though, some teams backtrack and actually pull this back into the room to combine it with either the two constructs in this room or the reaping at 60%.
Yeah, so this room's going to be really scary. This is the real pressure point of where bursting has a very high chance of wiping a team. So these little embalming fluids here are going to be casting these green circles all over the room, and if at any point a member of the team gets hit, they're going to start dropping these void zones on the ground that are going to do a ton of damage. It's going to be extremely dangerous. And so once these mobs start dying and start bursting, people are going to be taking so much damage. So the rogues are going to be able to cloak that off and they'll be okay. Everybody else is going to have to run away. As you see, now jumps so far away. The range on bursting is really scary. And so when a team did this yesterday, they ran all the way out into the hallway. However, Method EU has a little bit better efficiency in their positioning of this, so they're able to go straight into these internment constructs.
Yeah, that's exactly what I mentioned. Really efficient movement by them rather than just waiting around randomly in the hall. They don't have that happen to them, as we're seeing actually Abrakeydabra do. So they're just kind of idling here for a bit, losing a fair bit of damage. Dr. J finally getting that Cloak of Shadows up on that bursting, making sure not to die, as both teams in a similar fashion have pulled the GUIs, cleaved them down, and made sure did not have any bursting casualties. However, Abrakeydabra is now backed up into the hall, and some of them have actually not died, so they're going to be able to heal through this bursting wave, but they've lost a lot of time needed to kind of split up the chunks of damage to make sure they can survive the bursting as the last of the embalming fluids kind of rush in. Now, the even bigger problem is they've completely bottlenecked the hallway. They cannot move back safely into their room across the poison on the ground. We see Ashine has died. Swagless is barely getting healed up as well. So a bit of a misstep here for Abrakeydabra.
Yeah, unfortunately, they didn't quite have the damage. They moved out a little bit too soon, and they completely messed up the pool in a way that Method EU had absolutely no issue with. So now, while Method EU is able to go straight into the boss, Abrakeydabra still has to deal with both of these internment constructs. Now, something you have got to be careful with these mobs is, what may not be known is, whichever tomb you're standing closer to is where they're going to entomb you in. I think they pulled these mobs a little too close together. So what will happen is, one of these mobs is going to put somebody in this tomb here. You see the door is open now. They just let their friend out. And then a little bit later, the next one's going to cast. But you cannot interact again with this tomb for a little bit of time after. It looks like they got the timing right there, but if you time this poorly, the animation of the door closing will still be going when the next person gets sent in there, and then you could take some extra damage because you're not able to interact with it.
Yeah, right,
yet.
You are, yeah. No, it's very important to stagger or kind of desynchronize those two mobs, and they're definitely at the bare limit of that, I'm sure. They've practiced it a million times, so no coincidence there for them, but the two constructs are going down in a moment, but let's talk about Machimba for a second. We are on the second boss here for Method EU. Really clean run, except that one small death on Mir's hiccup earlier in the gauntlet, so they're doing quite well. Have combined their third reaping wave on top of Machimba. Now, Machimba absolutely trucks tanks. If there's any kind of tank that can, you know, just withstand the damage well, it is a Prot Warrior, and he does melee infrequently. We see a huge amount of damage coming out of now right now, surpassing the rogues with the reaping plus the boss affix here, and it is going to be solely Zalia's responsibility usually to break people out of that sarcophagus.
Yeah, those shadow smashes are really dangerous, especially with all the fire on the ground. It's another one of those mechanics were on Tyrannical. Standing in it for just 2 seconds is going to be enough to kill you instantly. And the other thing Machimba is notorious for is draining my fluids. You really hate to see him when he does that. And so what that's actually going to end up doing is it's going to slowly lower your health, and then until you get healed back above a certain health, you're going to be doing less damage. So Method EU has now used their Bloodlust on this, so we know that they're not going to be doing a very large trash pool of Bloodlust after the boss.
No, certainly not. They're likely going to have it available again either for the third or fourth boss, depending, or maybe even Shadow of Zul. I really doubt it, though, in a tyrannical setting. You don't see that kind of usage of it. 18% here for Method EU as they're rounding out 50% of their Bloodlust usage in just a moment. Should perfectly fall off as they deal with Machimba here as the room fills up with fire. Now, those fire pools or puddles, or, well, they're not really pools, puddles, but they do actually despawn later in the fight, so you can't actually fill up the entire room unless you're horribly inefficient with your positioning. So as long as you kite in a proper pattern, you're good. Really good movement here from Method EU. I love to see this. The boss dies right beside the exit of the room. As soon as it's dead, they're right up the stairs getting ready for what is probably the most, in my opinion, dangerous trash yeah. of the dungeon, especially if you don't have things like, you know, bops and dwarves available.
Yeah, of course. This trash is really dangerous because of these spectral berserkers. They put a really nasty bleed damage over time effect on the closest target to them in melee. Now, the rogues should be able to stand in there and use their dwarf racial to take that bleed off of them, or they should be able to parry it as well. So they do have a lot of ways to deal with it, but if it does, and it does stack as well, right? So if a member of the team ends up taking two stacks, they're almost definitely going to be dead.
And just as you say that, now actually has two stacks on him. The trick here really is he dips quite low, though, but Zalia manages to kind of get that heal on him, making sure he doesn't dip into death. Now, the trick here is that the bleed does last 10 seconds, and oftentimes berserkers reapply it at the 8-second mark. So you can either outrange them, in which case they will apply the bleed to their closest proximity target, the rogues, or just get them a 2+ second stun at the 8-second mark, making sure that the initial dots fall off, and then they can safely reapply them on the tank, unless you luck out with the parry.
So we're going to see, it looks like probably Abrakeydabra has not yet used their Bloodlust. So when a team got to this point in the dungeon yesterday with Bloodlust available, they ended up pulling this trash that Method EU is fighting right now alongside the trash that Method EU did in their first pool. So they're turning two pools into one, but it looks like Abrakeydabra is not actually doing that. They're doing the exact same pull that Method EU did, but with the Bloodlust as opposed to without it. This is definitely not what you want to do when you're behind one pool in the dungeon.
Yeah, I'm not sure why they didn't pull the Beastmaster as well. The two Raptors really aren't very dangerous. They had a favorable patrol right now from the Hulk, who's just off completely in the distance. Using Bloodlust, I mean, they certainly decimate the pack quite quickly. I love Divine Field's positioning there, standing right in between the two Hex Priests that spawn, getting that spell reflect up so that their Spirit Bolts were queued at the exact same time and reflecting two spells for the price of one. Bloodlust is still active for a few more seconds, so they get some benefit in the next pack, but quite a big put here from Method EU as they're dealing with their fourth Reaping Wave down the hall.
Yeah, so fourth Reaping Wave now for Method EU. They're dealing with it nicely with this one trash pack that was just outside of that door, and that's going to be what they're going to do next is going to be shrouding all the way to the next boss to skip the rest of this hallway. So this one, or it depends, sometimes teams like to kill this one trash pack here, but all this trash can be a skip now. There's what is it? This is a dungeon with only like 120% count available in the dungeon, and you can do well to skip a lot of it. So looks like they're going to be, I don't know if this pool is intentional. They're pulling packs that generally you see skipped with Shroud. This could be bad for Method EU. We'll see if this was intentional or if they're going to have to recover from this one.
I'm going to go out on a limb and assume it's intentional. I mean, we saw now charge into the first pack.
That's good.
The Rogues went and tricks the second pack to him. So they probably had all their kind of CDs ready for a big Klee Fest. We see a ton of damage coming out. Now is actually topping the damage meter. Just the pull was a bit rickety, and it is actually one, I don't want to say flaw, but weakness that Prot Warriors can have. If you're starting from zero rage and you only get that first charge in, you have only built half a shield block's worth of rage. So you are a bit vulnerable until you get your first shield block up on a Prot Warrior, which is why we saw some of a dip quite low, especially with that frost shot coming out of the Witch Doctor. But they managed to decimate it, no problem. I did see that they blinded the Berserker in the back to kind of alleviate some of that damage on now with the bleeds that come out.
So it looks like the way that they've opted to route this dungeon is they used blind on that Berserker, and then they're going to all be able to either vanish on the Rogues to drop combat or Shadow Meld for everybody else to not have to deal with those three Berserkers. And those are definitely the most dangerous mobs in that entire hallway. So skipping those Berserkers like that is really well routed from them. And this is perhaps why they got that 25-minute and 8-second time during time trials in this dungeon.
I mean, this is really, really clever play from them. They had a blind for the pack that they pulled. They blinded the second Berserker, then double sapped and went right past it. They're at 98% on the board. We know Shadow of Azul is going to give them the remaining percent they need. They're just going to stealth right past the Berserkers on the way out of this room and then easily complete their 100%. Huge time and a danger save for them. I mean, triple Berserker, nasty, nasty stuff, even a double. Abrakeydabra down but not out, of course, still dealing with the rest of the hallway. They're only now getting to that three pack in the middle of the bridge, but let's talk about this boss here for a second, Sours.
Yeah, so Kula the Butcher is really scary, and so it has two main abilities. The first one being this this axe bleed that we talked about at the beginning of the dungeon that's going to put randomly on any member of the group. There's no way to really bait this mechanic. You just kind of got to hope for the best, and maybe it will hit you, maybe it won't. I don't see it on any of the members, so perhaps one of the dwarfs got it, and they're able to get it off. And here comes Severing Axe. You see, the bleed goes on to Mira's, so I don't think he's got any way to deal with it. And you can see just how much it's chunking him. Look, but the Zalia's got full mana. It's not really an issue at all for him, so they've got to be careful with him. And the other mechanic, of course, is these whirling blades that go around the room. And it's good forward thought to be tanking that boss in the middle of the room when it's first, because after you down it, it's going to continue to periodically spawn in the room and spawn whirling axes from the center of the room there. So baiting the initial whirling axes in the center of the room means that there's never going to be any sort of nasty overlap from whirling axes.
Right, you are. We actually see, as you were saying, that exact thing happened. Now, Zanazal, the second boss of the council, we do know that they're always in a set order for the purposes of the tournament. Zanazal, the caster shaman boss, essentially, will cast Lightning Bolt occasionally on the tank, which can be reflected or, of course, interrupted. But the more important thing is interrupting the Poison Nova and when Call of Elements, which spawns four totems in a perpendicular fashion around the room, when those are up, it's important that you kill the Explosive Totem immediately, followed by the Earthwall Totem, which constantly pulses and absorbs shield on the boss. The remaining two totems, especially in a heavy melee group with a Rest of Druid, don't really matter too much. As you can see, they're kind of just leaving the Thundering Totem on the side for now.
The healer is in cat form this whole time, so he's not worried at all about getting kicked. And all the melee DPS don't have any spells that have any risk of getting hit by that Thundering thing that's going to be kicking you guys. So they're okay. They don't have anything to worry about. They do well to interrupt that Poison Nova. If somebody in the group calls it and maybe doesn't kick it or who knows what, if that spell goes off, you're almost certainly going to wipe, especially on an 18 Tyrannical. And we see just how quickly, look at how well they have coordinated their DPS split. So the healer and one of the rogues is enough to handle the explosive totem, while the rest of the group goes and kills the earthen wall totem, which puts a fairly hefty absorb shield onto the boss whenever it finishes its cast.
Now getting pummeled there a bit. Now, I think Method to use ultimate goal was really to kind of beat that second wave of Call of the Elements. They were just shy, about 2% off the boss for doing that, so they had to kind of incur a bit of time loss there. It would have been perfect otherwise for them. Finally, we are at Akali, the final boss of this council. We do have to watch out, though, for Xanazol now, as he will, just like the first boss, randomly appear on the platform and cast that Poison Nova, which could be detrimental for an all-melee group, so they have to keep their eyes peeled where it might spawn.
Oh yeah, so the Akali's got two really main abilities. The first one is this debilitating backhand on the tank, which will knock the tank back, and it will put a really nasty debuff on the tank that makes them take a significant amount of increased damage. And the other ability here is the Barrel Through, which is a charge on the target with the arrow above the head, which is then split with all the targets that soak it. Since this is a full melee team, it's very easy for them to all just stay in melee range and get full damage on it. And you see, now is unsuccessful at parrying or blocking the debuff, so he's got to do a little bit of kiting. And we see Zalia is able to run really far for him and taunt off him, which is a really good thing to be doing as a healer if you have taunt available to you, or as another DPS in the group to give the tank some breathing room.
Yeah, I mean, they certainly have enough mobility. I think it's more so to keep the boss centralized and the rogues and have to run all over the place DPSing. The reason I kind of snickered there is, you know, we said it might be dangerous for melee for Zal to kind of port randomly around the platform, but he ported right on top of them and cast Poison Nova, so really fortunate there for Method EU as they once again, as predicted, stealth past the triple berserkers and get ready for Shadow of Zul. Now, Shadow of Zul, definitely the most dangerous of pretty much any of the trash in here. Fortunately for them, it is not a fortified weak. Now, I just want to take a look, because right now, Abrakeydabra is at Xanazol, about to kill him. At this point, we had Zalia just barely healing. He was just DPSing to his max. He was about 9.1, 9.2k DPS at this exact point in the fight that Abrakeydabra's at. Elsrat only at 5.5, so they really went all in to maximize damage. You can even see here Zalia on one of the most dangerous mobs for a tank is already in cat form DPSing for Shadow of Zul. A lot of trust coming out of the group for him.
Yeah, so Shadow of Zul used to be able to be dragged around the room, but now he mostly just kind of hangs out in the center, and so he's going to be casting the Shadow Barrage on the tank, which does a ton of damage. So most tanks this expansion are fairly bad at dealing with big magic hits, and Prot Warrior, while it can spell reflect some of them, can't spell reflect all of them, so it's going to be taking a ton of damage from him. And you see this little kind of volcano-y zone over in the distance. So these things have a 15-yard range on the damage that they do, so as long as the group is able to stand far enough away from them, they're not going to be much of a threat to them. Otherwise, a member of the group is going to have to stand in it, and he's going to be taking a lot of damage from it.
So we see now go in and pop his Berserker Rage to make sure that he does not get feared by the mob's proximity going in and helping just kind of just cleave it down. They don't have an offensive dispel in the form of an Arcane Torrent, Priest, Shaman, etc. So they had to just raw kill it through its shield and make sure it died. And right down the stairs they go. They've already done their 100% and are on King Dazar. Their fifth Reaping Wave has spawned, and the final boss of the dungeon is here. They have Bloodlust available, and Saras, they're likely going to be saving it for that 60% mark when the second Mounted Raptor comes out, and King Dazar is he is damageable, but it transfers all the damage, of course, to his mount.
That's right. So what's kind of nice about that Shadow of Zul mob is that he doesn't actually spawn any sort of Reaping Ghost when you kill him, so it's very easy for the rogues to just vanish, as well as the rest of the group to use their Night Elf Shadow Melt to just avoid that fifth Reaping Wave and go straight into the boss. See, Method EU is, of course, holding their Bloodlust, because it's really good to use that Bloodlust to kill the mount when it comes out, because it has a really bad fear that if it comes at a bad time, it could potentially fear the tank so that his back is facing King Dazar when he does his slash, which is really bad as a tank.
Abrakeydabra just now crossing the bridge to get to Shadow of Zul. They skip past all the trash, have 3 and some change percent remaining for trash, but King Dazar just now hitting his 60%. We can see Tzala spawning here in that kind of golden river. Immediately, the Bloodlust does come up from the teams, and they'll be looking to destroy that raptor as quickly as possible. As mentioned, you want to avoid as many of these deathly roars as you can. Now can immune the first one with his Berserk Rage, but it will not be available for a second. But by then, the mount should be dead.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, they're just absolutely
so with the power of Bloodlust and rogues. So Outlaw Rogues are pretty crazy on AoE, right? But they're also the one of the best classes, if not the best, at two-target cleave. And all damage done to Zala, as well as King Dazar when he's on Zala, is going to be redirected into the mount. So you can effectively double the DPS you're doing to the mount by doing a nice two-target cleave onto them. So they kill that so fast with the Bloodlust that it's not even any threat at all that a second fear is going to be going off.
I mean, just look at the amount of damage support that Zalia is doing, too. There's so much trust and such clean play from the group on Method EU that Zayla is able to just kind of refresh some dots, get right back into cat form, and do as much damage as possible. Blade combo, the most dangerous, the main tank ability on this fight, extremely dangerous. A lot of damage over the course of four consecutive, increasingly large hits. It's just a joke for a Prot Warrior to handle with block up as well. So now is generally safe, allowing Zayla to get as much DPS up as possible. Now, King Dazar has entered the final phase where we see the trap spawning around the room in two separate configurations. One of them is this kind of clockwise pattern starting and ending at the river that they're at, and then of course the kind of checkers flip-flop one where there's a safe zone and a not safe zone, and then it kind of changes the suit.
Yeah, luckily this pattern always spawns in the same spot of the room and always rotates the same way around the room, so it's very easy to just stand in a certain spot every single time on this fight and dodge it perfectly. Looks like a flawless run out of Method EU, almost an identical time to how they did it in the time trial. It's just a couple of seconds slower, perhaps even a little bit faster. No, it looks like they're just barely going to miss out on time trials, but yeah, the shield block on King Dazar is a little disgusting. Nao's health wasn't even moving during the blade combo. The Prot Warriors are quite a tank this expansion.
I mean, it's not all about the damage that the Prot Warriors produce, but Jack, you're back.
Abrakeydabra is fighting for their very lives in the upper bracket here, needing this one to stay on top and to help secure their way towards the grand finals. Method EU looking absolutely bulletproof in here and going into Freehold.
I'm actually so excited for this dungeon. This is gonna be huge. I mean, these are two of the most coveted teams here, so I'm expecting to see some just things beyond what we've seen from other teams. Both teams starting off with a stealth and expected to be a really large pull here. Now grab some of the patrol as well, making sure they hit that 20% mark so they can drag the first reaping onto the boss.
Yeah, both teams look like they did the exact same pull here, the exact same way, so we'll see which team ends up doing more damage. You see now clapping away, and here comes the rogues right behind, and then the Death Knight skyrockets into the top. The power of Festermite and Bursting Sores is pretty phenomenal. The damage that Unholy Death Knight can do in situations like this is really just unmatched, as you can clearly see with these damage meters.
It's actually quite incredible to see how close together every mirror versus themselves was. I mean, the two Unholy DKs were reaching about the same amount of damage. Same with the Rogue, same with the Prot Warrior. Now, mirrors was a bit more lacking in damage versus Swagfist there, but we had some damage come out of Zalia to compensate, so pretty even between both teams as Method EU is getting ready in just a moment to pull the boss. Moved just slightly slower. The Reaper is spawning. Abrakeydabra has already started on Sky Captain Craig. Now, we are back in a tyrannical setting. Do have that teaming affix, more trash and more trash percentage required per kill, along with the Quaking. So these are still a full melee comp, along with Resto Druids that are hungry to get in there and get some kitty DPS in. So you got to be careful with those Quaking Sours.
Yeah, so Quaking is a kind of a problem, but it's not so much of a problem when you have three melee. They just got to do a little bit of spreading out. And as long as they kind of have it figured out, they shouldn't be losing too much uptime. So both DKs, if you check the inspect element, you can see they're opting to use slightly different Azerite setups, where Frag is using, actually, I believe, the exact same Azerite setup that we saw Shakib from Method NA using in this dungeon yesterday, whereas Shine here is using a completely different setup where he's using a Treacherous Covenant Festermite setup, so he's doing a ton of damage when he's at full HP, but if at any point in time he rips threat like we saw happen earlier in a Freehold, then he's going to die almost instantly.
I mean, we're just seeing here, Divine Field unfortunately does get clipped by that frontal on Abrakeydabra, but one of the main things, and you know, I was watching it a lot in the last dungeon, is just how aggressive Zalia is playing as a healer. Every single chance he gets, he's at a distance, he's pouring some wraths in, he's in melee, he's going cat form. Whereas you look at Elsarat on Abrakeydabra, he's playing incredibly safe and defensive. Nothing but regrowth spam coming out of him, safely moving to the side. You can even see it on the damage meters right now. And those kind of little tidbits really add up towards the end of a dungeon, especially when you have two teams of this caliber. But we do have a death going down from Fragnant, so they're going to have to use their battle res early, as we still have 40% left on this tyrannical boss, which is quite a lot of health to chew through.
Yeah, so this boss is really, really scary. So teams have to be really carefully watching out where this parrot goes. And so the way that the pooping in this boss works, if you're not familiar, is when the bird flies up into the air, it'll then drop these green puddles on the ground on the closest target to it. So the team is just kind of doing a good job trying to position themselves around the room to avoid getting pooped on. That's just why Zalia is so far away, as opposed to being in melee, giving the boss a really big bite in cat form.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, when it comes down to it, we both have a death on either side, so we're going to kind of cancel each other out. I was about to say that the 5 seconds is really important for with teams that are so close together, but that's been canceled out. Both bosses at 10%, completely synchronized. One death on the board for each team. Divival dipping quite low there, spamming some ignore pain, making sure he gets that 50% absorb in as much as he can, as the boss actually does hit quite hard along with a combination of a frontal. Could be lethal. Nonetheless, at this point, anybody dying would be able to hang on. Mirrors dipping to 11% damage. Both of the bosses go down in favor of Abrakeydabra first, just by a few seconds.
That's right. Both teams dipping really low there. You see both healers completely tapped on mana. Now, the Azerite Powder Shroud that the boss does a lot of damage, and so there was a couple times where it was hitting more than one target, because perhaps there was a little bit of movement from all those void zones on the ground, so when it hits more than one target, the healer is going to fall behind, and then if they've got a dodge, then they're going to be losing uptime, and now the damage comes out at fairly set intervals there, so there's nothing too much to worry about, which is why you don't see any panic in the healer going earlier, which could happen if you freak out when you see that happening to your team.
So we see a similar pull here as they grab the Enforcer on the bridge, run right past it, and everybody's shadow melds, vanishes, or already pre-stealths to get rid of that aggro. Method, are you doing both teams doing
it's
a
like
very
identical routes.
Yeah, pretty much identical routes so far. So both teams grabbing a fairly sizable pull here, likely will be close to, if not proccing, that 40% reaping, at which point I assume that they're going to grab it into some more trash, likely not into the second boss, the Council of Captains, just yet. But then again, we haven't seen them do freehold just yet. Now dipping pretty low here, a lot of damage coming out of these mobs. Should be easy for them to handle. He can always bolster that with a bolstering, assuming he has that talent last stand, which is pretty good key cutter for the Prot Warriors. If you want to check that, Sours, in just a second there, we'll let you know in just a moment.
For now,
yeah, just have a look there. Abrakeydabra, similarly large pull to 33% now on the board, and I got it. I will have a look, and you go ahead.
Yep, so these guys are both doing a really good job. Method EU did a little bit better with their cleaning up of the trash there. They're just a little bit ahead on time, killing mobs slightly faster. Dealing with some of these small yellow mobs here, I believe this should be enough count to proc the reaping, whereas Abrakeydabra is now kind of doing the first variety. They've pulled one of these monkeys, and this probably casts the most terrifying ability of this expansion, Slippery Suds. An ability, you see this debuff on each member of this team, this little bucket, and whenever you jump, you're gonna stun yourself. And I don't know about you, Sloop, but I can't help myself from jumping, especially when I have this debuff on me.
It is the most dangerous and irritating debuff I've ever played with in my life. It's 30 seconds long, but you do have to remain composed and deal with that. Lot of trash coming in here for Method EU as the 40% reaping wave is combined with quite a bit of trash here near the second boss's area. Abrakeydabra still has not procced their reaping. They just do so as I finish that sentence and will be getting ready for an equivalent pull. Huge amounts of damage coming out of Fragments, well passing over 500,000 DPS.
Yeah, look, I think Abrakeydabra might be doing a slightly larger pull here. They've gotten quite a few mobs, and some of them are crowd controlled. You see the power of the Death Knight kind of spike up, and this is kind of one of the points in time where having a Prot Warrior, perhaps a little bit worse than having a Blood Death Knight, we see a couple of these casters on the side of Abrakeydabra left out casting on them without any way to move them. Elsewhere would have to typhoon those mobs in, or they'll have to line of sight or kick them to get them into their stack. But Abrakeydabra is now starting to fall like one pull behind at a time of Method EU as they continue to blaze on. They've started the RP now. They've grabbed this pig. Once you start this RP, the healer kind of breaks off from the team when they're doing trash that doesn't require any healing. And you talk to this ring of booty over here. And then about a minute later, the pig's going to jump down. And then once the team joins up there later, they can all grab their hogs and finish that RP event.
Right you are, Sours. Abrakeydabra, of course, finishing up thus the rest of the trash here as they run over to the Ring of Booty. Method EU has now spawned their 60% reaping wave along with a ton of trash. I mean, this is just an absolute slugfest of AoE damage dominance from both teams. Fragments once again skyrocketing in damage. We did see actually Jay output a fair bit more damage in the previous large pull compared to Jinji. Probably got the five-roll god that he needed for that pull, but nonetheless, big pull coming up here for method to use. Certainly, they are slightly ahead, as the paths do look to be quite equivalent for both teams.
Yeah, so this is kind of the story of these two teams, where both teams have been putting on phenomenal performances throughout the entire tournament so far, but Method EU has just been that much cleaner and that much faster every time over Abrakeydabra, where the same thing was kind of happening in King's Rest, where, Method EU had a little bit of a different route in there. They were still just going faster each thing at a time as they continued to, go through the dungeon. But now that these teams are using the same route, which is the first time we've really seen two teams in a dungeon be using almost identical strategies here, the Method EU is just executing everything that much more cleanly, that much more quickly, and they're just pulling further ahead as a result of that.
No surprise to see the Unholy DK Ashine absolutely just decimating this group while they deal as much damage single target, which is really the kind of bottleneck here in the form of Ludwig von Tortolan, making sure to kill this mini-boss style mob as quickly as possible, and then we'll see exactly how they handle his version of the Lost Soul, which we do know spawns with 50% of the original mob's health here. Method EU at 71%, getting ready to pull Trothak, which we see spawn on the right side of the screen. Now, a very inefficient boss to have a full melee comp on, but it is a mirrored comp at least, so no particular advantage to either team for this boss.
Yeah, the Rogues can stand quite far out, right? They do have that additional attack range, so they can do a little bit to deal with Trothak, but looks like Method EU isn't quite going into him yet. They're pulling a little more of these yellow mobs to cleave down during the fight, going to gain a little bit of damage on all of the members of their team. I believe the Windwalker benefits quite a lot when he can hit additional targets onto the boss, and Fragnus is going to, of course, be doing a little bit of extra damage thanks to Bursting Swords, as well as we saw him use his Army of the Dead here on Trothak.
So I don't think we saw a Crusher being pulled from Method EU on their side earlier, but we do have the Crusher present here for Abrakeydabra, getting ready for Trothak to spawn in just a moment from the side here, as they have finished off Ludwig von Tortolan. Want to make the most efficient use of their time possible. Perfect 79% here on the board for Method EU, certainly not wanting to spawn, at least not yet, the Reaping on top of Trothak. Perhaps they'll want to combine it when he's at a lower, safer percent. But we do see Trothak coming down in just a moment for Abrakeydabra as they finish up the last of their trash too. 77% on the board. I'm not sure if this is actually going to prompt their Reaping. It does. Yeah, so they will get the fourth Reaping and pull it right on top of Trothak. So much more aggressive approach to this boss from Abrakeydabra.
You see the same cooldowns coming out from Ashine here with his arm. Army popped. So, but now we're going to see the difference in the routes that these two teams have chosen for this boss, where Ashine is going to be able to do a ton of damage to the boss with his Bursting Swords, as well as to all the Reaping, so they're able to deal with it very handedly. And now a lot of this damage is kind of wasted on these smaller Reaping mobs, but it does mean that he's going to be doing a little bit of extra damage on the boss. And then they've got to deal with his Lost Soul the entire time, but the Outlaw Rogue is going to be doing quite a lot of two-target cleave thanks to this mob that has so much health with the Reaping.
Yeah, it really the Lost Soul is more of just a nuisance for the tank, and everybody just displaces you slightly, doesn't do any stacking debuff on you, since it's a tank-style, unCCable version of the souls that spawn for Reaping. So not a big deal for them as long as they just cleave it down effectively, making sure it's dead before Trothak, which easily it will be, as it's already half the health of the remaining that Trothak has. Trothak at 64%. For Abrakeydabra, Method EU still chiseling away at 27%, has not proc'd their final wave of Reaping. Likely they're either waiting it to, if they're going to do it, they need to do it soon with Trothak, but it seems to me like they're going to probably pull it on top of the Council of Captains.
I think that definitely makes a lot of sense to me that Method EU could be gaining a lot of damage on the Council of Captains with the Unholy Death Knight. That's not going to be available, of course, for Abrakeydabra, but the boss is very dangerous in and of itself without having the additional Reaping wave there to deal with. So we'll see how that ends up playing out. Both teams still neck and neck in this race. Trothak on 13%, dying slowly. You know, with these melee heavy comps, you are losing a lot of uptime dealing with the sharks. We see it's running after Zalia right now, so they do nicely to bait it out into range. But if it goes into melee, then that guy does nature damage, so it does magic damage to these guys. So dangerous, can kill you very quickly. So as long as they're doing a great job here, they haven't had any slip-ups. There's like so much that you've got to be worried out for, whether it be the sharks, whether it be the quaking on the whole team. Any sort of misstep on this boss can very easily cost a member of their life.
Certainly can. Want to bait those fish out. As Method EU cleans up Trothak, their second boss in the order, of course, one of the nice fun things to see in this dungeon is really the open nature of the dungeon. I mean, these teams kind of have it down to a whim. They're, you know, they already know their pathing, but for us, any of the bosses could come forward from them. They kind of group up in front of the Council of Captains, ready to pull it. So we're going to see here if they opt to use their Reaping on them. It doesn't seem that they do. Bloodlust is available, so we'll have to see if they decide to use that. They're actually holding on to Bloodlust as we speak. They might pop it after the first Grapeshot jump from Eudora, but I think by now they would have used it if they were going to use it. So likely they want to combine some kind of massive pull after the boss, would be my guess. Abrakeydabra not far behind. Trothak 11% about to fall. Already have dealt with their Reaping Wave, also holding on to their Bloodlust, though.
Yeah, so Bloodlust, I guess, for whatever reason, Method to use is opted not to use it. Now, the Grapeshot in Captain Eudora is quite dangerous on this boss. If he targets the same member of the team in succession, it's very easy for the healer to fall behind on them and kill them. And so the other mechanic that this boss has is you see there's two different brown circles that can occur on this boss. There's the small brown circle, which is going to be giving a buff or a debuff, either critical strike chance, haste, or a damage taken over time effect. And so the bosses are affected by both. So if the boss gains the crit, it's very dangerous for the tank as they're going to be doing a lot of tank damage. And likewise, if the bosses gain the haste buff, they're going to be swinging very fast on the tank and doing a ton of damage to them. But if you can get that debuff onto the bosses, they can die remarkably quickly with it.
It's a huge amount of damage, and the efficiency of this boss kill really comes down to handling those brews properly. And it's not even just damage on the tank. I mean, imagine Eudora getting the crit buff with one of the powder shots. It can easily just one-shot one of the players, so definitely don't want that happening as we see mirrors get quite low here. Abrakeydabra, unfortunately, does have Jade die. They're going to need to use a revitalize there on the side, and a poorly timed quaking interrupts the res from Elstrad on Dr. J, costing them another 10 seconds or so waiting for that quaking to pulse just so J can be rezzed here. Two deaths on the board, and I mean, against a team like Method EU, that is a hugely crucial error. It's going to cost them a lot by the end of the dungeon. Method EU has now downed Eudora and is at 30% on Raul.
Yeah, so for those wondering what Jay was doing off all the over there on his own, the RP event, the roleplay event you've got to do to activate this boss is there's a pug that'll spawn in the previous room that you've got to chase in a circle, and then you have to interact with a cage to free a mob so that you can engage the boss. Now, if you don't do that, you'll end up fighting all three bosses at once instead of two bosses, which will make them do 100% increased damage, which kills the entire group almost instantly. You have to do the event every single time when you want to fight this boss. And so that mistake there, they were already behind Abrakeydabra, and the death there cost them time. They were very slow on that event, and so that is causing them to fall further and further behind. Dr. J goes down.
It's just such a costly error. Like, they need to use the Battle Res on Jay right now, obviously. Battle Res not available for sub 5 minutes for them. Dr. J would not have died there if he had his Chief Death available, which he unfortunately procced in that mistake made earlier spawning the pug. So the mistakes are just starting to kind of group up for them. Bit of clipping here from the quaking on Method EU. Nothing to be too worried about as they do finish off the Council of Captains and are headed over to the final area here. Now, they're 84% already. They've had their Reaping, their penultimate Reaping, and they still have Bloodlust available, and they're pulling Harlan Sweet. I'm expecting to see some kind of Bloodlust plus Trash combo here.
Oh, yeah. So Method EU grabbed the last bit of Trash they needed for the Reaping, and then I thought they Shadow Meld skipped it, but apparently not. Some of it is joining them here in the boss fight. So they have Bloodlust available. They're doing a massive Trash pull with the boss. This is a lot of kill count. I don't believe this is quite enough kill count to actually get them to the 100% mark, but they're in the first phase of Harlan Sweet. He's not really that dangerous. He's only going to be casting, you see this arrow on their monk on one target. So they have a lot of room now to maneuver around the platform and deal with these Fire of Woodsmen on the ground. And once they get him now to the 70% mark, he's going to start casting that on all of the melee as well as the healer in the group. And so having that additional space with dealing with that trash pack is going to give them a lot more freedom in how they handle this boss.
Yeah, a lot of damage you need to chew through for Harlan before he reaches his DPS thresholds. Now, once he gets to 30%, he will get that 100% increased damage taken, but also increases attack speed. Once again, Protwear doesn't matter, or really won't be too dangerous for that Protwear. Now, if I'm not mistaken, actually, second phase starts at 60%, question mark. So we'll see it in just a moment.
Sounds right.
Within 4%, as we only saw one member get the cannonball there. So just a moment here, Harlan Sweet will hit phase 2 for Method EU, 93% on the board. They'll be looking to clean up that remaining percent, likely with the Ravagers and painful motivation that we've seen so many other teams do already in this dungeon. Abrakeydabra at 5% on Captain Rule have already had their fourth Reaping Wave, but at this point, I mean, there's no way these guys aren't looking on a second monitor. They know Method of Use ahead, so they're probably going to be forced to do a pull that is not entirely comfortable for them, but they have to do it. I'm expecting to see a lot of trash join the fight here on Harlan's Suite along with that Bloodlust.
That's right. This looks like it's going to be another clean 2-0 for Method EU all the way through the winner's bracket. They haven't dropped a single match, where Abrakeydabra did drop a match earlier against Method NA earlier in the tournament, and it looks like they're going to drop two in a row here to Method EU. So it's time for them to start thinking about how they're going to handle the lower bracket. Now, they don't know yet which team they're going to be facing down there, but barring some critical mistake for Method EU, this is going to be a quick 2-0 for these guys.
Yeah, I mean, Harlan Sweet just now down to 40%, getting close to that third phase at 30. We see the multi-cannonball strike come out. The group moves very well together. Zayla's still hanging out by himself, wants to do his own thing, not burden the group, not get burdened by the group, but also getting ready to root any of those Grenadiers that come down to make sure they don't reach the pack and explode for a substantial amount of damage. Harlan Sweet now has been pulled for Abrakeydabra. We still haven't seen the use of that Bloodlust, 88% on the board, but I mean, Method, they're just hitting the phase now. Sours, 93% trash on the board. I don't think there's any way.
Oh, yeah. They were brave enough. They know that they're in the lead. They didn't care. They pulled more trash with the boss now that he's very low and just dying so fast. Now, one of these mobs is casting Painful Motivation. It's going to be killing all the trash fairly easily. Now, it's good, does add a level of complication to the pool, but it's nothing that Method EU cannot handle. Only one death on the board. A remarkable performance out of these guys. Once these mobs die, it will be the 100% Reaping, and then the boss should fall shortly after.
Yeah, I mean, by the time the Reaping kind of does its RP, Harlan Sweet is dead 100% at the exact same moment, and Method EU sweep once again 2-0. I mean, there's just no stopping these guys right now.